To all of our problems, all of the things that we are hurting, a lot of us are hurting today. And Father, we just know that you are there to help us through everything. We just need to reach out to you.
Mm-hmm. Creation's crying out from the dark. So many questions the world is reaching. So many hurting, so many lost. With all this striving, who can we lean on? Creation's crying out from the dark.
Listening to the song, and it just came to me, he's like, no matter where you are in your walk with God, he loves you. If you've made a mistake in the last week, or you know, just recently, even today, he loves you. All you got to do is you come to him and say you're sorry. He loves you that much. There's no disappointment in his eyes. He just wants to embrace you with his love. So as we sing this song, I Am Loved, think about that. And if there's something that just is really weighing you down, just let him know that you are here and you want his arms around you. Let him embrace you this morning.
With open arms, how can they? too high, there's nothing to measure. Cause I am your child, and that's all that matters. There is no disappointment in your eyes. There is no shame, there is only pride. I am loved, Father, I'm loved by you. There is no distance in your embrace. Over and over again you say, I am loved, Father, I'm loved.
John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world. So remember, whatever you're going through, God loves you and he's there for you. Receive it this morning.
Thank you. As we thank you, Lord Jesus, as we continue to worship him. God could be called many things, but one word that describes him is God is love. Thank you, Father. We just worship you. It's not the wrath of God. It's not the punishment of God. It's not the anger of God. It's the goodness of God that leads us to change, leads us, Father, to growth. Leads us to come up, leads us to make the adjustments that we need to make. It is your love for us that gives us the room, Father, gives us the motivation to rise up in life and win in life and make you look good. And it's all because of your unconditional love, that even before we knew you, even before we recognized you, even when we did things that hurt you and said things in ignorance. You overlooked it because you put all of our confusion, you put all of our dysfunction, you put all of our ignorance on your sinless Son. And so we thank you for your love. Your love never fails, never quits, never gives up, never stops. And our faith works by a revelation of the width, the length, and the depth, and the height of your love operating in and through us. And so, Father, I just thank you that your eye is not just on the sparrow. Your eye is on us. Not in judgment, not in anger, but in compassion. And so, Father, it's your compassion that brings healing to us. It's your compassion that breaks addictions over our lives. It's your compassion for us that changes us from being selfish to rise up and make a difference as your agent. And so, Father, we truly do lift up the brokenhearted. You said in your word you're near to the brokenhearted. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your wonderful, wonderful healing virtue. Your the revelation of your love. You love us so much that you heal our diseases. Your word says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." You forgive all our sins and you heal all our diseases and you save our life from destruction. We praise you for it. Thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, welcome to Faith Christian Fellowship. Whether you're here in person or watching online, God is good. He has something good in store. And I would just encourage you to allow the goodness of God to make a difference in your life today. Just allow Him to reach out to you. Let's make our confession. Let's release our faith. Let's believe God for His supernatural help in our lives. Say, "This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today, I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I'll never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. Never, never. Never the same. In Jesus' name. Amen." May be seated in His name. I want to talk to you today about dealing with negative thoughts. It doesn't matter how holy you are. It doesn't matter how good of a person you are. It doesn't matter how much faith you have. There is no person alive today that doesn't have to deal with negative thoughts, fearful thoughts, worried thoughts, stressful thoughts. Even Jesus was tempted and tested in all manners, just like we are. And the temptations are in our thought life, and that we're going to be assaulted in our mind. And we cannot stop anxious thoughts, selfish thoughts, fearful thoughts from coming to our minds, but we have the power, we have the ability to choose what thoughts that we're going to think on, that we're going to allow to meditate on and to have rolling around in our mind. There are so many opportunities to be worried and to be stressed out and to be anxious when it comes to life, wondering what's going to happen. Like the old hymn went, that we don't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. And that is the key to come to a place of peace, because when we watch the news, for instance, and we see all the suffering, all the hunger, all the violence, all the murder, all the perversion, all the injustice going on, and we get thinking about that, and it causes us to look at life through a negative lens. And yes, we need to be aware of what's going on in the world, but our minds must be clear. Our minds must be in a position, in a place where we are not pessimistic about life, that we don't look at life through a cloud of darkness, that we have vision, that we have enthusiasm, that we have hope, that we have confidence, that better days are in front of us, and that we are not just moved by everything that we hear and everything we see in life. And we recognize, yes, these things are happening, but we understand that God has something better for us, and we can be part of what He's doing. People are worried about the economy. They're worried about their safety. They're worried about the future and what does it hold. But there's good news. And the good news is that God wants to change every area of our life. He wants to be involved. He wants to bring wholeness. He wants to bring prosperity to every part of our life. Let's look at 3 John 2. And this is God's will for us. This is God's dream for us. Beloved, I pray, I desire. Well, the Amplified says, above all other things, that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. And of course, this scripture teaches us that we prosper in life. We come up in life to the degree that our soul is healthy, that our soul is prospering, and our soul includes our mind, our thoughts, our will, our attitudes, all these things include our soul, that when our soul is healthy, that our thought life affects every aspect of our life. When our thinking improves, our life improves. And when we recognize that all the things that we desire, a healthy body, a hope for a future, improvement in our relationships, every aspect, coming up financially, they're all linked to the health of our soul, to where we are in our psyche, to where we are in our thinking, what is going on in our mind, living stressed and worried and bitter and angry and pessimistic and hurting. It hinders us from being productive. It hinders us from being effective in life, and it even affects our immune system. When we're down in the dumps, and when we're soured in life, it affects everything around us, because what happens on the inside affects of our life, in our thought life, in our thinking, in our attitudes, affects what's happening in these other areas that we want to change so badly in our lives. The experts are saying that we're in a mental health crisis. And the Bible doesn't use the words mental health. It uses healthy soul. And really what our culture is saying, that we are very unhealthy in our soul, in our culture, in our emotions, in our thinking, in our attitudes, that it's an unhealthy thought, mindset that we have, and it's affecting us. And our thoughts need to come to the place of peace. I just have a stat here. It says the Center for Disease Control and Prevention in the United States estimates that stress from worry accounts for 75% of all doctor visits. In other words, the doc may have us stick our tongue out, or he may take the hammer and hit our knee, and he may, you know, diagnose different things, but he realizes, and or she realizes, the medical profession realizes that they are dealing with symptoms, not the cause of what is our issue. 75%, and some of them feel it's even higher. And that's why when we go to, a lot of times we go to the doctor, we come back, oh, they didn't help me a bit. All they did, all they want to do, they're just married to the chemical companies, and they're just trying to rip us off. But really what it is, the real problem is between our ears. That didn't come out right, did it? No. The real problem is our thinking. And our real problem is we're not at peace. And there's turmoil. There is things going on in our lives that God wants to bring peace to. And he wants us to be in a place where we can be healthy, where we can be helped. And one of the things that is an issue from the Canadian Medical Association says that the doctors are stressed out. That they did a survey, and the majority of the doctors are so stressed out. There's so much to do, so many people waiting to see them, that they're thinking of cutting their clinical hours in half. They're thinking of doing less. Some of them are thinking of even changing professions because of the stress. People that are stressed out are coming to them for answers, and they're just as stressed out as the people coming. And it is really an epidemic, and we call it mental health, but the Bible calls it protecting our soul, prospering in our soul. And God wants us to prosper in our soul. You know, last year I went for my physical, and my blood pressure was high, and my doctor says, what is going on with you? Because he knows one thing, I don't like taking medication. So he said, like, what's happening? Because I've never had anything like that. And he said, is it? Well, you know, he's concerned. He says, what's happening? And I said, I don't know. I says, you know, when I go to bed at night, and it's like I'm like Jacob wrestling the angel of the Lord, but it's not the angel of the Lord I'm wrestling. And tossing and turning, and I get up tired. And the thing of it is, I told him, I says, and he said, the medication's not going to make any difference. Whatever you're doing, you've got to let it go, let it drop. And I'll give you, you know, a little bit till you sort this out. And this is the whole truth of it. The Bible has the answer. But your spouse, your doctor, your friends, the government, not even God can make us forgive people, can make us let things drop. Not even God can make us not be worried and stressed out. Not even God can make us stop overworking and doing things we shouldn't do. God has given us the power of choice. And so this is something when it comes to mental health, when it comes to dealing with negativity in our lives, this is something that this is our responsibility. This, I know we like to put the blame, you know, they've just got to come up with another cure for this. What's the cure for diabetes? What's the cure for all these rashes on my face? And what's the cure for this and that? We need to understand that the cure came 2,000 years ago. And God has peace for us. But there isn't anything that we can rub on. There isn't anything that we can drink. There isn't anything that we can shoot that can give us lasting peace. We got to be able to deal with our thoughts. We got to do something about our thinking. You've probably heard this quote before. It's not so much what you're eating that's killing you or hurting you. It's what's eating you. And, of course, that is the issue when it comes to mental health. And there's so much to do that, you know, and I'm sure it's in the same in what you do as what we do, but a lot of our time is involved, Linda and I, is the work of the ministry. And it's like with the doctors. No problem doing overtime. That's not an issue. And we're beginning to realize, you know, we don't really have hobbies. We just work. And so we recognize, even when we do something different, like shopping, we were in Winnipeg this week, and Linda says, you know, I'd like some me time. Would you go with me to the stores? And I said, sure. But I didn't realize that everything we do is high speed. And after just a couple stores, I said, are your legs hurting? She says, no, I'm just getting going. I says, man, I think I could walk to Winnipeg and back, and I don't think they would hurt like they're hurting right now, and we're just getting started. Even shopping's stressful. It has to be on rollerblades. It has to be full speed. We spent a couple days with our son and his wife this week, and we went skating at the Forks. I thought, we went skating at the Forks. We've been going to the city all of our life, and that's the last thing we ever thought of doing was we're going to spend the afternoon skating. I mean, we live beside a lake, and when it's frozen, we could skate to our heart's content. We've been living there for quite a while. The last thought that came to our mind, let's go skating for the afternoon. Let's relax. But my point is that, and of course a lot of our society has no problem with this, but a lot does. Because our culture is over-medicated. And there isn't anything, you know, I'm not bashing medication, I'm not a psychologist. I'm not bashing therapy and all that stuff. All I'm saying is, if we're going to get help, we're going to have to learn how to deal with our thought life, if to come to the place of peace. That's what I'm saying. And there's a verse in the Bible that I'd like to share with you that'll help us in this. That we can come to the place of perfect peace. And it is Isaiah 26 and verse 3. And it's talking about God Almighty. It says, you will keep in perfect peace some of the people who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you. No, it says, you will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you and whose thoughts are fixed in you. And when we look at this scripture, it's perfect peace is not circumstantial peace. Circumstantial peace is that we are at peace when something turns out. There are times things work out just the way they're supposed to. And that's nice when that happens. We like that, but it's temporary. And when we look at the word peace, this word perfect peace is from the word shalom. And that word shalom, it means prosperity, it means health, it means protection. It means, it's one of the all-inclusive words of the Bible. When we're walking in peace, all these things that redemption provides for us are included in it. Because when we're at peace, when our mind is at peace, then what happens is it releases God, it releases health, it releases wisdom, it releases energy, it releases strength in our lives. When our psyche is right, it's kind of like the governor of the anointing that's in our spirit, the joy or the peace that's in our spirit. Our mind has to come in line. And when our mind is right, it affects us spiritually as well. It affects us financially as well. The perfect peace is not occasional peace. It is not circumstantial peace. Shalom peace is what we just read about, perfect peace. This isn't something you can smoke. This isn't something you can drink. This isn't something you can buy. This isn't something that you can order off Amazon. It has to do with our minds, with our thinking. And it originates from God. It has nothing to do with the circumstance. This is an unchangeable thing. This is something that originates from God. It comes from God. And we allow our minds to be stayed on Him, and then we have this peace in the good times, in the bad times, when we're grouchy, when we're happy, when we're up and when we're down. This peace doesn't change. Our circumstances are constantly changing. The reports of what's going on around us are constantly changing, but that peace, this perfect peace, is unchangeable. It's like everything. It's like God Himself. God never changes. Our mind is a battlefield, and most of life's battles are won or lost in our thinking. He or she who keeps his or her mind stayed on me, the Lord says, will be kept in perfect shalom peace. That's a wonderful promise. And it's found through a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Who will experience shalom peace? Those whose minds are fixed on all the world news of all the suffering, all the war, all the tragedies, all the drama that's going on in the world. If we listen to that day and night, does that come bring us to a place of perfect peace? What about if we keep our mind stayed on the U.S. election? Will that keep us in a place of perfect peace? Not maybe. What about if we're scrolling on social media all day, wishing we could be somebody else? Is that going to bring us to a place of perfect peace? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Jesus came to make us whole, to make us healthy, to make us what we could never become in our own strength and our own power. Jesus said, I have come that you would have life and have it in abundance to the full until it overflows with joy, peace. Remember Jesus and his disciples caught in a storm at sea? Before they got in the boat, Jesus said, boys, I've just given out, I've just poured out everything I have. I've just given everything I've got. Let's push off. Let's go to the other side of the lake. And they got in the boat, and Jesus just immediately went straight to sleep. And they got just a little way off from shore, and they got into a storm, and the Bible calls it a mega storm. You know, maybe you heard of mega mall or something like this. Was a mega storm. This was something that was violent. This was something that was life-threatening. And the disciples were freaking out. And what was Jesus doing? He was sleeping in faith. He was resting in faith. Faith is a rest. He was in perfect peace. He was in perfect peace. What was he thinking? What was going on in his mind? What God was going on in his mind is he never did anything unless he first heard from the Father. And the Father, he had heard the Father saying, we're going over to the other side. He didn't say we're going under. He heard that we're going over. So we can't go under if we're going over. If we're going over, we're going over. Even if it looks like we're going under, we're going over. So he was at peace with that because that's what God said. The disciples were freaking out. Why? Why weren't they in perfect peace? Because their minds, there was lots of thoughts coming into their mind. And I'm sure those thoughts came to Jesus too. They were thinking, we're not going to make it to the other side. We're going to die. We're never going to see. I'm never going to see my wife again. I'm never going to see my children again. I'm never going to see my friends again. This is it. Oh, this is a terrible way to go. I'm sure that's what they were thinking. They were anything but at peace. And what were they hoping? That the storm would stop so they could have peace. But that isn't how faith works. A lot of times, you and I are looking for things to improve so that our mental health will improve. Isn't that true? We're hoping that if things settle down a little bit, we can get happy. We can come to the place of peace. We can get enthusiastic about life again. But no, it doesn't make any difference. With God, our part is to get our mind stayed on his promise. What has he promised? What has he said? If our minds are fixed on Jesus, even in the tough seasons, God will provide all we need. What do we need? Perfect peace to face the storms of life, to face the disappointments of life, to face the trauma in life, to face the crisis in life, to face walking in the mall for hours and hours and hours, even though it's only been 5 minutes, it feels like hours. But Isaiah 26 verse 3 says that we can have perfect peace. Another scripture we can look at, this is kind of like the New Testament version of Isaiah 26, 3. It's found in Philippians 4, 6 and 9. This will help our mental health. Don't worry about anything. Well, that's nice to say, don't worry about anything. But how do we do it? Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he's done. Then you'll experience God's peace, perfect peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise when that person pulls in front of you on the highway. Keep putting into practice all you learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing. Then the peace of God will be with you. And you say, I know that's all right when things are going right. This is what happens. In our lives, when we make the decision what we think on. I'm not talking about we're in denial. I'm not saying, you know, it's like the man that came to Pastor Olstein one time and his arm is bleeding. He had got attacked by a dog and the dog had chewed up his arm. And he says, look, Pastor Olstein, at the arm the dog didn't bite. Well, we're not denying that that our world is in turmoil, that our circumstances sometimes are in turmoil, and our relationships aren't everything that they should be and could be. A lot of things that we would like to see improve in life. I'm not saying, see, we're not denying that those things are facts. But what I am saying is, we still decide what we think about. In spite of what is going wrong, in spite of the challenges we're facing, we get our thinking going in the right direction. The change that we need to have made is in our thinking. In our thinking. These scriptures make it very clear that we get to choose what we think upon. The Bible would be very unfair. God would be very unfair to ask us to fix our mind on certain things if we couldn't do it. Jesus could in the storm. We can in the storm. You know, I was a Christian a long time before I realized that I could think about what I thought about. I didn't know that. I wish somebody had told me. Especially when things aren't going the way you want them to go. It would have been nice to know that we could have peace. That we don't have to think negative things. That we can deal with things in a right way. Martin Luther King said it like this: you can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can stop them from making a nest in your hair. You know what I mean? Thoughts come to all of us. Wrong thoughts, selfish thoughts, entitled thoughts. It's all about me thoughts. Woe is me thoughts. Self-pity thoughts. Victim thoughts. It's not fair thoughts. These thoughts come to everybody. But we don't have to entertain. By an act of our will, we can choose to think whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever of virtue, whatever of praise, whatever of excellency. These eight things that Philippians 4 talks about, those are things that we can choose to think about. And if we will, we'll come to the place of peace. The good news is that you and I are not a victim of every thought that comes to our mind. And we don't have time to look at it today, but 2 Corinthians 10, 3 to 5 tells us that the weapons of our warfare are not human. They're not natural. They're not flesh and blood. They're not bombs and guns and tanks and now it's drones. That isn't the biggest battle that we're fighting on a daily basis. The biggest battle that we're fighting is lies and worry and pressure and hurt and pain and discouragement and depression. These are the things that we deal with on a daily basis. And God has given us mighty weapons, but they're not natural weapons. Like when we think of a weapon, you know, the Ukraine keeps asking, we need more weapons, we need more weapons. We're going to lose the war if we don't get more weapons. Please send us weapons. God has sent us weapons. But the weapons of our warfare are not human. They're not natural. They're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. What's a stronghold in our mind? A stronghold in our mind is a lie that we have listened to so long, we actually believe it's true. We actually believe we're dysfunctional. We actually believe that we can't be who God said we could be. We've actually believed that we're going to be sick all the days of our life. We actually believe that we're not going to meet the right person. We actually believe that our kids aren't going to serve the Lord. We actually believe these lies. And they become strongholds. You know what we have to do with them? We have to learn how to deal with them. We have to recognize these are lies. These contradict the truth. And we have to, first of all, we have to recognize this is from the pit. This is not God. This is not bringing me into a place of perfect peace. And then we got to cast them down and we got to replace them with what the B-I-B-L-E says. And we need to get what's in the book into our heart and on our lips and get it on our mind so that these things, these lies, don't keep us in a place of depression and discouragement and frustration in our lives. You know, we are the children of God. That's what the Bible says. When we come to the Lord, we are children of God in the family of God, but that's not all we are. We are soldiers in the army of God as well. There's a balance. We're in the family of God, but we are soldiers in the army of God, and we are fully equipped to fight. But the biggest fight is our thinking. It is for our identity. And peace is something that God gives to us. And I'm telling you, we get to fight for it. I know before I was saved, one of my best friends was electrocuted working on a steel tower for the hydro. And I went into a place of depression. I went into a place, because with my life the way I was then, I couldn't stay home one night for love nor money. I had to be with my friends, had to be out in the town, had to be out and about. My dad would always take me and shake me and say, look, you can't burn the candle on both ends. You can't be out all night and work all day. It's going to be trouble. But when my friend died, I didn't want to see anybody. What was happening? We called mental health today. I called, my soul was not prospering. There was trauma. There was a loss. There was a tragedy that came into my life. And there was grief in my life. There was sorrow in my life. And I didn't know any better. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what I'm telling you about. And I'm in this funk and I couldn't get out. And I'm telling you, there isn't any medication that could get me out. There isn't any therapy that could get me out. People say, cheer up. You know, people say, you know, you're a pastor. When people lose a loved one and people go through trauma, what do you tell them? Oh, good question. Because I'm telling you, you don't tell some, hey, cheer up. That's what my buddy said. Snap out of it. Cheer up. That's when you pull your gun out. Because the thing is, we're not in a place. We're hurting. We're in pain. And it gets in our mind and it becomes a stronghold. But somehow, I met Linda. Backslidden as she was. I guess that's the only way we would have ever met. And through her family, she didn't really lead me to the Lord. I think she was worse than I was. But through her family, I got saved. And come out of that funk, I started to realize I'm not a victim. Yes, I lost my friend. But I've got more than what I lost. There's things we can't control. When I was looking into this, you know, depression, mental health things, they said it's amazing. In the wealthy countries, this is an epidemic. Because we in the West think if we've got enough money, we can control everything. And what we can't control, then we're devastated. In the poor countries, they hardly have any mental health. They're not thinking they can control their day, every single day. Sometimes we think in the West that every day is a happy day. I mean, as long as we have on the right clothes, and as long as we drive the right vehicles, as long as we live in the right neighborhood, as long as we have the right vacation, we're going to be happy. No wonder we're messed up. And, you know, the people that don't have anything, they're not concerned about a lot of that stuff. It's the last thing. You ever notice the pictures of these people with a bloated stomach? You always, how white their teeth are? They're so happy. Haven't got a care in the world. I'm not advocating for poverty. I'll tell you that. What I'm doing saying is there's so much we can't control. And we've got to learn to pick our battles and recognize we can't control everything. But our circumstances, but we can always control what we think about. And I know personally, when I come out of that funk, yes, if we're going to live long enough, we're going to lose. We could lose our, we could have health issues. We could have relational issues. We could lose loved ones. We're all going to go through it. It's like this during COVID, they interviewed this one lady. She was almost 100 years old. And they said, are you afraid of COVID? She says, afraid of COVID? Not at all. You afraid of the vaccine? Are you kidding? She says, I've been through the Second World War. We've had scarlet fever. We've had the mumps. We've had chicken pox. We've had polio. She had a whole list of things. We went through the Great Depression. And she listed like about a thing. She says, I'm afraid of nothing. Mm-hmm. And you just think of where. You just think of the mindset that God wants us to have. And I don't even think she was a believer. It's just, this was just her life experience. That some, you know, that generation, I just can't believe it, how resilient they were. It's like my sister said about my mom and dad. She says, I think they're immune to germs. We'd come into their house and they'd have a roast on the countertop and it's got about an inch of green, well, that's exaggeration, quarter of an inch of green on top. Hey, Michael, would you like to have some of this? And that, I'd be pushing daisies. Them? They just wipe it off. Boy, is this ever tender? Why? Because their psyche. You know, everything wasn't a big deal. Because I'd see my dad working with 2,4-D. And his wrists were about the size of my shoes. And he'd reach in there and he'd get these filters, wash it around there, blow it with a rope. Was he worried about, that's not good for you? Like these guys, you couldn't stop them. But see, they didn't know all the problems that were going around. They were on the farm. They worked hard. They didn't know all the things that were harmful. Somebody bought them a water filter, but they're a little McGregor Scotch. Never changed the filters. We went over one day and looked at that filter. It was about as black as pitch black. Oh, would you like a glass of water? And I think, oh, you know, I'm not that thirsty. But they could drink that. It wouldn't bother them. What I'm saying is they weren't even saved. But they didn't think on everything. The boogeyman was out to get them every night. They've been through so much stuff. Instead of saying, well, what next? They were just, next. Bring it on. Bring it on. And they lived to be almost 100, both of them. If I ate one of their meals one day, I wouldn't live to see the night. Because I know what harm it is going to do. I think as Christians, we're a little that way. That we just know so much of what's wrong. That we're all stressed out, we're all worried. It's just like Teal Osborne when he went on the mission trip. He says, imagine. He says, I've been all over the world. And he says, almost everybody can quote Job's boils, Timothy's weak stomach, and Paul's thorn in the flesh, but can't give you one scripture that promises divine healing. And I think as believers, a lot of times we're that way when we're in a world that's corrupt and dark. We're the light. And our mind isn't in everything that's going on around us. We have access to the peace that passes understanding, that's not circumstantial peace, that is not temporal peace, that is not momentarily peace, but this is a consistent peace. This is an unchangeable peace. This is something that changes our circumstance. The circumstances don't change it. Totally unaffected. One more just before we go. Mark Hankin's mom. Mark Hankins is a pastor in Louisiana, and his mom and dad had a Assemblies of God church there for quite a few years. And Mark was brought up in the home there. There was a young man wanted to go to Bible school, so the church decided they would sponsor him, and he'd come home for the weekends, and they would have him preach the odd time and give him, you know, a few bucks and help him out. So they put him through Bible school. And when he graduated, he came home and split the church. Knew who all the givers were, took the money people out of the church, and started an own church. And I'll tell you this, God has never split one church, only the devil splits a church. But she went into a state of depression. Mark says for 2 years he never saw his mom other than to come out to eat. His dad pastored the church and dressed the kids, who knows how he dressed them and looked after them for 2 years until she got a little book talking about some of these things I'm talking about right now. And she began to realize she was in such a state of depression she wouldn't leave her room. She got a hold of that book and she found out she could think about what she thinks about. And I'm telling you, in the praise and worship, she got a hold of that and she got free. And I'm telling you, she's the most vibrant, enthusiastic, worshipful person that you would ever meet. You wouldn't want to start up the band with her in the room. She would be on her feet and she would embarrass you. Why? Because she was down in that place where she didn't know what to do with her thoughts. And she sunk into a deep hole of depression. But when she got out, she got out. And that's what I'm saying today. That you and I can rise above this. Yes, we're going to deal with all kinds of pressure. We're made for this. We're brought to the kingdom for such a time as this. We have the weapons. We don't have to phone somebody and say, bring us more weapons and we'll win the war. The weapons have been deposited. The weapons are here. We just have to learn how to use them. And there's this peace. And I'm trusting God's showing all of us how to deal with negativity in our lives. We are not pessimistic. I don't care how dark the world gets. We're the difference makers because we have access to think right. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you came and you took our dysfunction, you took our mental distress, you took our confusion, you took our pain, you took our emotional garbage, and you suffered with it. so that we could have perfect peace. We could have shalom peace. We could have peace, not as the world gives peace, but supernatural peace, abiding peace. That no matter whether we're in a storm at sea, whether we've lost our best friend, or whether somebody's walked out on us, makes no difference. The peace of God never changes. Our circumstances are always changing. People are always changing. But Lord, your peace never changes. Never quits, never stops. It's always working. It's like Waymaker. Never stops, never quits. Thank you, Father, that even when we despair of life, there's a peace that rises up within us that makes all the difference. Every head bowed and everyone praying, you're here today and maybe you're in a state like I was. Just in a funk. Just couldn't see how to get up, how to get going. Couldn't see that the best days and the brightest days are not behind, but they're right in front. And you're stuck. And if that's you, just raise your hands. This happened, that happened. I got hurt, I had this disappointment, I had this loss. And I've never been able to get over it. If that's you, just raise your hand. God wants to set us free. Because, my goodness, if he can set me free, he can set anybody free. Well, Father, we just thank you for this day. Thank you that you're the God of all peace. And that your peace passes all understanding. And Lord, we recognize when the enemy tries to bring those negative thoughts about what we lost and what could have been and what should have been to our minds, we cast them down. We'll never blame God. We'll never be mad at God. We'll never shake our fist at God in anger. Lord, we recognize that you're the Prince of Peace. You're for us, not against us. You're not the one that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. You're the one that has come that we would have life and have it in the abundance to the full until it overflows. We thank you, Father, that you've armed us for strength for the days ahead. And we thank you for showing us how to deal with the challenges of life. Father, we're not quitting. We're not giving up because of what we see, what we hear. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that our minds are girded with truth, the truth of your word, that's totally setting us free. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Lord. Well, God bless you. Shalom to you. Nothing missing, nothing broken, nothing lacking in your life. We just speak peace to you. Peace to your life, peace to your ministry, peace to your family, peace to your home. God bless. Have a wonderful week.